Jesus. Amen and amen. You can be seated. Praise God. I want you to turn with me to Joshua. We want to look in the Old Testament, Joshua, the 24th chapter. And we're going to read verses 13, 14, and 15. And as you read the book of Joshua, you'll see a type and a shadow of the church. And so you see Joshua is a type and a shadow of the Lord Jesus Christ. See, a lot of people think that Canaan land, you know, used to have songs, you know, when I get over in Canaan's land. Thought Canaan's land was heaven, but no, heaven's not Canaan's land. There's no battles to fight in heaven, amen? There's no giants to kill or walled cities to defeat. No, Canaan's land represents the life that we live now as a Christian. It represents crossing over. When they crossed over Jordan, that's a type of baptism. And so they were, you know, they were dead to the past and they were alive unto God. So we find then that when you study out the book of Joshua, you find then that there's some revelation there, that there's some battles to fight even after you get saved. Anybody found that out? Or am I the only one that's discovered that so far? No. You'll find out that even after you've given your heart and life to the Lord, there's battles to fight. You know, if crossing Jordan, the Bible tells us it was a type of baptism. And so if that's the case, and they were baptized and they came and that's a type of the new birth, then the very first thing they had to do is learn how to shout. Amen? Because they had a walled city that they couldn't get down except they praised God and shout and pray and bless Him. Amen? And then they had to go out and go against enemies. They had to use wisdom. And so it's a walk of salvation. It's a walk of victory. And so Joshua brings all the people into the land, gives them all their inheritance, and now he's summating and bringing it to a conclusion, and he's showing them everything is done. And then he's going to give them the requirements of God. In verse 13 of Joshua 24, he says, I have given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you did not build, and you dwell in them, and you eat of the vineyards and olive groves which you did not plant. Hallelujah. That's the covenant of God, isn't it? In other words, he's saying, you got all this by God's grace and mercy. Sure, they had to fight. Yes, they had to shout. Yes, they had to march. Yes, they had to obey and believe God. There's a God part and a man's part. But how many of you know without God, it don't matter what your part is? Amen. It's God that gives us the power to get wealth. It's God that gives us the grace and the ability. So therefore, he's saying that the Lord blessed you with all these things. Everything you've got is because of the Lord's blessing. Aren't you glad? Galatians 3:13 and 14 says that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law that the blessing of Abraham could come on us. Amen? Aren't you glad today that you can have these same things? Listen, if God could bless them with cities they didn't build, vineyards they didn't plant, wells they didn't dig, homes they didn't build, and bring them into that because they obeyed Him, and we live in a covenant with better promises established on better things, how much more should God be able to bless us in our life? Amen? See, the new covenant is a covenant of battle, but it's also a covenant of blessing, praise God. It's a covenant of victory. It's a covenant of being overcomers in this life. In Colossians chapter 1, verses 12, 13, and 14, it says we're to give thanks unto the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints. Aren't you glad you're qualified today to partake of the inheritance of God? Why? Who has delivered us from the power of the authority of darkness and has conveyed us, transferred us, put us over into the kingdom of the Son of His love, in whom we have redemption through His blood and the forgiveness of sins. Aren't you glad God has already put you in His kingdom? Come on, you've already crossed Jordan. You're already in Canaan's land. You're already in a place where you can possess the blessings of heaven. Amen? You can possess God's blessings in your life. How many of you found out, though, that even though you walk in the blessing of the covenant of God, you know that you're saved, you know that Jesus is your Lord, you know that victory is in your life. In fact, you're getting your prayers answered and God's blessing you. How many of you found out that there's sometimes still a tug or a draw or a pull trying to pull you away from God? Anybody found that out? Your past still tries to sneak up and get you sometimes, or the enemy still tries to throw something against you? Let me show you what I'm talking about. Look in verse 14. Now, therefore, fear the Lord. Now, that word fear doesn't mean be afraid of Him. That means this: reverence, respect, and honor the Lord. Okay, that's how you fear the Lord. You respect Him. You honor Him. You appreciate Him. So He says this: now, therefore, since you've come into your blessings, God's blessing you, God is with you, you've experienced His grace, respect, reverence, and fear the Lord. Serve Him. Everybody say, serve Him. Notice that. Doesn't say just believe in Him. He says serve Him. Serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. Amen. Now, what's Joshua saying? He's saying, even though you've been brought across the River Jordan, you've been brought into your inheritance, you've been brought into your blessing, God's blessing you, good things are happening in your life, that doesn't mean you've arrived yet. There's still things needed to be done in your life. Amen? There's still a sanctification process that needs to continue in your life. Some people come and get saved and they quit. And that's as far as they go with God. Some people come and get saved, get filled with the Holy Ghost, then they quit. And that's as far as they go with God. Some people come and get saved, get filled with the Holy Ghost, and learn a few scriptures. And they quit, and that's as far as they go with God. Some people come in and get saved, fill the Holy Ghost, learn a few scriptures, and start giving and get blessed, and then they quit. That's as far as they go. But God is speaking through Joshua and saying, listen, you can keep on going with God, but there's going to be a tug on your flesh. There's going to be a pull on you that's going to try to get you to separate yourself from God and pull you away from God at times. So he says, here's what you're going to have to do. You're going to have to put away. In other words, you're going to have to do some things. You're going to have to take a stand against sin. You're going to have to take a stand against your past. You can't let your past dominate you. You cannot even think about that past. Remember Paul writing in Philippians chapter 3, you know, he talks about, you know, I haven't arrived, I have done everything just perfect, and right down the line, paraphrasing it. But then he gets down there and he says, but this is one thing I got a hold of. This is one thing that I practice. This is one thing that I am doing in my life. I'm forgetting those things which are behind, and I'm reaching forward to those things which are before me. Amen? I'm striving to lay a hold for that which Jesus Christ reached down and laid hold of me. I want his perfect will in my life. To do that, you got to put away some things. You got to quit thinking like you used to think. You got to deal with some of those temptations and tests and trials. And you got to deal with some of those things that are trying to pull you back from God. You just have to walk away from it. You have to deal with it. 2 Corinthians 7:1 says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves. Notice that. You're to take the word of God and cleanse ourselves from what? All filthiness of the spirit and flesh, and what? Perfect holiness in the fear of God. Hallelujah. What's he saying? Keep striving to live for God. Why? Because the key word in all three of these verses you're going to find is the word serve. Because what Joshua is saying to the people is this: there will be a constant battle in your life as to who you will serve. Amen? See, here's the thing, folks. The devil doesn't matter, care what you believe. What matters to him is what you do. And there's a battle today, not just for your ideology, not just for your philosophy, not just for your belief system. There's a battle today for your service. Are you hearing me? See, the devil wants you, you go to the worst sinner, you go out here to the worst reprobate, you go out here to the meanest person you can find, and you talk to them a lot of times, and you get them to be honest with you, and they say, oh, I believe in God. You go out and talk to somebody, and you say, you believe in doing right? Yeah, and they're stealing something at the moment. Are you hearing me? Somebody says, what are you talking about? I'm talking about James said even the demons and the devil believes in God, but that doesn't do them any good, does it? So the battle isn't so much for what you believe. The battle is for what you're doing. Who are you serving today? And then Joshua says, serve the Lord in verse 14. In other words, he says, don't let anything stop you from serving the Lord. The word serve in the Hebrew, and also I looked it up in Webster's dictionary. I've got a dictionary at home, and I thought, well, I'll see what he says. And they're both very close, and Webster's actually brings it out and says a little bit better. He says, to serve means to render obedience and worship to God. That's pretty good, isn't it? That's one of the definitions of serve. To render worship and obedience to God. To comply with the commands or the demands of. To comply with the demands or commands of. Hallelujah. In other words, what's Joshua saying? He's saying this: don't comply with the demands and the commands of the world and what you came out of. Don't render obedience and service to your past. Render your obedience and worship and service to God, and order your life according to what he wants done. Amen? And then he says this. Here's his final challenge in verse 15. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, look at that. If it seems evil to you to serve the Lord. Now, we think evil all the time as some murder or some this or that. But you know, in Numbers, he talks about evil being those who were in doubt and unbelief. And so when he says here, when he says, if it seems evil, he says, if it seems too hard for you, or if it seems like, you know, God's asking too much, or if it seems like, you know, I can't have any fun being a Christian. Are you listening to me? You know, I'm missing out on all the world's activities. If it seems like it's just a drudge to serve, it's a drag to serve God. Bring it up in our modern translations. He says, if it seems like something that's just not appealing to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Notice he says that. He said, it's a choice you have to make. Choose for yourself. Choose for yourself. You have to make your own decision on this. Whether you're going to serve the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. What's he saying? You're either going to serve the gods of your past and you're going to fall back in sin, or you're going to get caught up in religion and doing whatever right now. There's a battle for your service, and somewhere down the line, you as an individual are going to have to choose who you're going to serve. Not who you're going to believe in. Who are you going to serve? And then look what he says. He says, but as for me and my house, here's my choice. We will serve the Lord. Now let's put it like this. As for me and my house, we will render obedience and worship to the Lord only. As for me and my house, we will comply to the demands and the commands of the Word of God. Just for me and my house, I don't care how you act. I don't care where you go. I don't care what you do. I don't care what your attitudes in life are. You're not going to choose my life for me. I choose to worship and serve the Lord God Almighty. And I'm going to do it with my actions. I'm going to do it with my obedience. I'm going to do it with my worship. I'm going to do it with my attitudes. Everything about me is going to show respect and reverence to God for blessing my life. Amen. So you see, we have to do that. And you know what Joshua was saying to him? He said that if there are people around you say, I ain't going to go do that. You have to make up your mind. You're going to go worship with them and serve the world, or you're going to come to church and worship God. See, a lot of us, the problem with us, the reason we're not serving the Lord is we need to get delivered from other people. They're not, so you don't. They're not fanatic, so you're not going to be fanatic. They're not wild for Jesus, so you're not going to be wild. Because you don't want to rock the boat. You don't want to lose your friends. You don't want to be ostracized. You don't want to be an outcast. But I want to tell you something, folks. You and I need to make up our minds. We're going to either be followers of the world or we're going to be leaders for God. I'm going to say it again. We're either going to be followers of the world or we're going to be leaders for God. Because the moment you decide to follow Jesus Christ and serve Him, you're going to be a leader. Amen. And there are going to be people looking at you. But Joshua is telling the people, there's going to be a battle for your service here. There's going to be a battle for your worship. There's going to be a battle for your obedience. There's going to be a battle for who gets your actions and decisions in your life. Amen? And that's so today. This is an Old Testament. Somebody says, what's that have to do with me? Well, look in Matthew's Gospel, the 24th chapter. Matthew chapter 24. We go over here, and I want to look at these just a little bit from the attitude of service, serving the Lord. Jesus is teaching here in Matthew chapter 24. We'll pick it up in verse 1. And he's talking to them about the buildings, and they're talking to him. And so in verse 2, he says, all these buildings are going to be torn down. It's not going to last. And so he gets their attention. Then in verse 3, it says, now as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying or asking. Now in verse 3, they ask him three different things. There are three different questions here. And the rest of this 24th chapter, Jesus answers these three things. And here's the first question. Tell us, when will these things be? In other words, when is the temple going to be thrown down? Number 2, and what will be the sign of your coming? When is the rapturing of the church? And number 3, when is the end of this age or this dispensation coming to pass? Okay? Age is always a dispensation. So they're wanting to know, when is the temple going to be torn down? When are you going to come back and catch away the church? And when is this thing coming to an end? Three different questions. And so the Lord begins to answer these questions to them, and he begins to give them some things that they need to look at. Now, you need to understand something before we get into these things. Jesus is reporting to them things that are going to happen. He's not causing them to happen. He's just telling you they are going to happen. Are you listening to me? Just because he says there are things coming doesn't mean that God's doing it. How many of you know God does not cause war? God's a God of peace, not of war. God doesn't cause hatred. God causes love. God doesn't steal, kill, and destroy from people. God blesses. Amen. Jesus said in John 10:10, it's the thief that kills, steals, and destroys. I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So therefore, Jesus is not saying that God is causing all these things. He's saying these things are going to come. And one thought of this says, these things are going to be coming because of the fall of Adam and sin in the world. It's inevitable that these things are going to happen. They're part of the cycle of life. And so Jesus says these things are going to happen, but then we also understand that he is directly talking about before he comes back, because he talks about a beginning down here in just a few moments. And so therefore we understand that even though there's been wars, there's been problems, there's been famines, there have been all kinds of things for the history of man, because it started when the world was placed under the curse by Adam. Romans, the 8th chapter, says the entire creation is groaning and travailing, trying to get out from under this curse. So we understand that these things are part of the fall of man. But Jesus says they're going to be ramped up in the last days. They're going to get more intense in the last days. He's not causing them. He's warning them. And you got to understand something. Jesus is speaking to the disciples. So what's he doing? He's talking to you and me. Amen. So when he's talking about these people in these verses, and we're going to take verses 1 through 14, he's not just talking about sinners. He's talking about Christians, believers. So let's hear the answer that Jesus gives. Verse 4, and Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. One translation says, beware that no one misleads you into error. Meaning what? There are going to be a lot of things trying to get your attention to mislead you and get you from serving God. That's what he's saying. Don't let any of this stuff cause you to quit serving God, because you're to serve the Lord. You're to render service and obedience and worship to God. Amen? So he goes on, he says this, for many will come in my name, saying I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Now, notice he says many will come in my name. One translation I got to reading, it says, many will come and inject my name as being from me and do all they can to deceive you with false doctrine. That's going on today. People taking good truth and perverting it and making it say something that it doesn't say. Why? To mislead you, to get you from serving God, to get you to get carnal again, pull you away from God. Then he says in verse 6, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. Anybody hearing of any wars today? Any rumors of wars going on? See that you're not troubled. The word trouble there means frightened or fearful. You know why these wars and rumors of wars and all this stuff's going on? You turn on the thing and you're talking about all these different groups, these radical groups, and they're beheading people and they're killing people and they're trying to destroy and they're trying to do their own little thing and set up their own nation and stuff, because that religion has been a world-conquering demonic religion since it was formed. And you hear all that, and you know what the whole thing is on that? It's to get you troubled or frightened. The word trouble there means to be frightened or scared. But how many of you know you're not supposed to walk in fear? God's not given us a spirit of fear. So therefore, we know that God didn't send this, because he didn't give the spirit of fear, and all this is coming to cause you to get troubled, frightened, and fearful. John said in 1 John 4, he said, fear has torment. Fear is not of God. He that fears not made perfect. And so therefore, all this is coming to stop you from walking in the perfection of God and walking in the blessing of God and walking in the anointing of God and serving God. Then notice what else he says. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. In other words, he's saying, you're going to see all this stuff, but don't think that it's over. Listen, folks, you know, we're not anywhere near the Lord coming yet. Look what he goes on, he says. For nation will rise against nation. The word nation there is the Greek word ethos. Ethnos. What are you talking about? Ethnic group against ethnic group. You know what's going on today? There's as much racism, prejudice, bigotry going on, more so now than there has been in you can think of. People just hating people because they're different. People rising up against people because they won't fit into their little group. That's going to get worse as we go on. Why? It's to get you to get upset. It's to get you to get mad. I'll show you. Look what he goes on. He says, for kingdom against kingdom. Those are natural kingdoms and rulers rising up. You can see it. You can see it in Europe. You can see it in the Middle East. Kingdom against kingdom. Different people, dictators rising up, different armies fighting against each other, different ones trying to conquer. And he goes on, he says this, and there will be famines. Anybody seen the scarcity of food and scarcity of junk going on? Of course there is. People afraid. Pestilences. The word pestilence here is plagues. It also means diseases. Anybody heard of any diseases that's causing fear? See, all these things are to trouble you, to get you out of faith and to get you into fear, to get you frightened and tormented. And what am I going to do? The Ebola, it'll never hit the United States. Oh, really? Now, all of a sudden, they're afraid it's going to be a plague across our country. Wonder if that has anything to do with the end times. Wonder if that has anything to do with service unto God. Because, see, all these things are to deceive you. Jesus said, he said, let's go back up to verse 4 again, where he said, take heed that no one deceive you. Take heed that you do not get led into error. What are these things coming to do? To get you scared and troubled. And there'll be earthquakes in various places. Anybody heard of any earthquakes? Probably in the last few minutes. There are earthquakes happening on every continent. They're concerned about earthquakes. There's been, in this country, we had earthquakes in the last week or so. They're getting more. Let's read on. All these are the beginning of sorrows. It's a period of time Jesus calls the beginning of sorrows. It's not the end yet. It's the beginning. These things are going to be amped up. Why? To mislead you. To bring torment to you and fear to you and trouble to you. Why? Because Satan doesn't want you serving God. Then they will deliver you to tribulate up to tribulation. The word tribulation there means persecution and affliction. What's it? Well, listen, folks. In our country right now, Christianity is under greater attack than ever in the history of this nation. Kids are being kicked out of school for wearing a Jesus t-shirt. They're being kicked out of school if they got Jesus armbands. You pray over your food and they're going to suspend you for 3 days. In some districts across this country. And there are people all over the place. What's going on in this country? A small group of idiot atheists are getting God taken out of everything in the world because Christians said, Mike, what's going on? Don't dare pray before a football game that our kids would be protected. They'd rather see him beat up and legs broke than ask God for his grace and mercy in a football team, because we don't want to offend one idiot sitting down there on the sideline that needs to get offended so he gets saved. That's right. Come on. Listen, when I call an idiot, I'm being more gentle and kind than God does. He says a fool says there is no God. God calls him a fool. So I'm not doing that. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. And it actually really says, if any man be an agnostic idiot, let him be an agnostic idiot. Okay? I'm being real biblical. Somebody says, you're being hard. No, I'm not being hard. Somebody needs to preach some truth here, because you see, he says, don't be misled. There's an attack on your service. There's an attack to get you to be quiet. There's an attack to cause you to sit down and compromise and don't be what God wants you to be. Look what he goes on, he says. And many will be, he says, nation against nation, ethnic. And then verse 10, he says this. Verse 9, let's go back. They'll deliver you up for tribulation and kill you. And you will be hated of all ethnic groups for my name's sake. Any Christians being killed in the world today? Entire communities being killed because they believe in Jesus. Right now, across the Middle East, where all this junk's going on, Christians and Muslims and Jews in certain parts have lived together. And now they're being killed because they're Christians. See, we think just because it's not happening in this country, it's not happening. Folks, it's happening. This is a world picture, not just a United States picture. That's right. The kingdom of God goes beyond the tri-state. That's right. So Jesus is not talking to Christians in America. He's talking to Christians. And they're going to be killed and hated. And like I said, right now in this country, Christians are hated. You know that, that this nation, the leader, the progressive liberal leaders of this nation hate Christianity. They see it as the enemy. In fact, every socialist, communist country that's ever been raised up, the first thing they do is get rid of Christians and churches.
That's right.
Because Jesus brings liberty and freedom. And you can't have liberty and freedom in the hearts of people and dominate them with a dictatorial government. So they got to get rid of Christianity. So they hate Christianity. Jesus said it'd get worse in the last days. And look what happens. What's all this coming for? And then many will be offended. The word offended there means fall back. Not talking about sinners. And many believers and many Christians will fall back. Many Christians will get offended because of the lawlessness, because of the injustice, because of the attacks, because of the persecution, because of all the junk that's going on, the trouble and the fear. Many will get offended. Say, well, if God's God, why isn't God taking care of this? If God is so good, why don't God stop this? Jesus told you it was coming. He's warning you to get ready for it. Don't be misled. Don't get offended. Many will fall back and will betray one another and hate one another. Look at that. Instead of walking in love and serving God, they hate God and hate the church. And God let me down and God didn't do this and God didn't answer my prayer. And all of a sudden they start blaming Christians. And they persecute the very ones that they used to stand in church and worship God with. See, that's service. There's an attack for service. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love and passion of many Christians will grow cold. I want to ask you a question. Anybody here know somebody that 2 years ago were shouting and praising God in church? Excited for the Lord? And they're not in church anymore? Anybody know somebody that a year ago? How about 6 months ago? How about a few weeks ago? And all of a sudden now you can't get them to church. You can't get them to praise God. You can't get them to read a Bible. You can't get them to pray with you. Who are they serving? See, in Romans chapter 6, Paul said, whoever you yield yourself to be servants to obey, that's whose servants you become, whether of evil unto sin or of righteous unto God. He also said in Romans 6:13, not to yield your members as instruments of sin, but to yield them as instruments of righteousness. In other words, I'm not to yield my hand to the devil, my mouth to the devil, or my actions to the devil. I'm supposed to be serving God.
Right.
I'm supposed to be rendering obedience and worship to God. I'm supposed to be complying and walking my life, ordering my life according to His demands and commandments. And Jesus warned me these things are coming. And He said, beware, be on guard, because these are all things coming to trouble you and deceive you and to pull you away from God. And people are going to tell you it's okay to live certain ways when it's not. And they're going to twist the word. And then it's going to get lawless around you. And people, you think, well, my God, those are the most evil people. How are they getting by with that? And you're going to get upset. And then you're going to watch the TV. And you're going to see all these newscasts. And they're going to just aggravate you. You're going to go, where's God in all this? Why is God letting this happen? But you got to understand, God said, these things are all going to happen in the last days. He warned us it's going to happen. Gets bad. And you're going to have to make up your mind. Am I going to let all this junk around me steal my passion? Am I going to quit serving God with passion because it's not easy? Am I going to quit serving God with passion because people have fallen away? Am I going to quit serving God with passion because there's injustice going on around me? Because there's racism going on around me? There's bigotry going on around me? There's prejudice going on around me? There's people accusing me? There's people mocking me? And people, in fact, I know some people and they're not nearly as committed to God as I am and they're more blessed than I am. What's wrong with this picture? I'm not going to church. Guard your heart, because it's an attack for your service. Who are you going to serve? Who are you going to render obedience and worship to? The first group fails the test because they get offended. They lose their love for God. And in fact, they become part of the problem. But that's, don't stop on a negative note. Let's go to verse 13. But, aren't you glad for those godly but? Look what he says. Before you get upset that everybody failed, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. He's not, come on, folks. He's not talking about getting born again. He's saying if you dig in your heels and you decide whether you think it's evil to serve God or not, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. I don't care how lawless it gets, I'm going to serve the Lord. I don't care how much terror comes, I'm going to serve the Lord. I don't care how much famine there is, I'm going to serve the Lord. I don't care how much bigotry there is, I'm going to serve the Lord. I don't care how much injustice there is, I'm going to serve the Lord. I don't care whether you hate God or not, I am going to serve the Lord. Nothing is going to move me away from serving my God. And I have the love of God on the inside of me, and love endures everything, and I'm not going to quit. And God says, if you will set yourself that I'm not going to fall away, be misled, deceived, and I'm not going to quit, he says, if you'll stand strong, you will endure every attack this time brings at you, and you'll be safe from every bit of it. Somebody says, aren't you afraid of terrorism? No, if I endure, I'll be safe from that. Aren't you afraid of the lawlessness? No. Aren't you afraid of the plagues? No. I'm not afraid of any of that because I'm standing on verse 13. I believe that I can endure all things through Christ who loves me. I believe that greater is he that's in me than he that's against me. I believe that if God be for me, who can be against me? I believe and know that in all these things, I'm more than a conqueror through him that loves me. I believe this, that I'm the head, not the tail. I'm above only, not beneath. I'm an overcomer in this life. I can get through because God has already made a way. Hallelujah. And when it's all said and done, I'm going to be standing with my hands lifted because I am going to serve the Lord. Hallelujah. And then look what happens when you make up your mind. How am I going to serve the Lord? Verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world as a witness, and then shall the end come. How am I going to do serve the Lord in this hour? Instead of complaining, I'm going to declare what Jesus says. I'm going to be a part of the answer. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell people what God can do for them. I'm going to stand up when everybody else is fussing and praise God. When I go through a battle, I'm going to keep my eyes on Jesus. When I don't feel like going to church, I'm going anyway. Whenever I feel like quitting, I'm going to get up and keep on going on. Whenever I feel like nobody loves me, I'm going to love anyway. When nobody else is praising God, I'll praise him anyway. When I feel sick, I'm going to say Jesus is my healer. When I got a need, I'm going to sow a seed and believe God God's my provider. When they say you can't get through, I'm going to step back and let God make a path for me and get me through because I'm going to make it. And I'm not going to be ashamed to tell you who's going to get me to the other side. I'm going to preach the gospel to you. I'm going to tell you Jesus is your answer. I'm going to tell you God still loves you no matter what you've done. I'm going to tell you God gets you through this thing. I'm going to tell you God will heal you. God will deliver you. God will forgive you. God will make your life worth living. God is your answer. And I'm going to preach it and people are going to get saved. Hallelujah. Come on, and in the midst of plagues and famine and war and tribulation and persecution, revival's going to come to the land, and Jesus is going to be glorified. The gospel's going to be preached, and we're going to see people saved. Hallelujah. Come on, we're not defeated. We're more than conquerors. This is our time to shine. Our time, Brother Bill, our time to stand up. Jesus warned us it was coming, but then said, just go ahead and endure it. Stick your shoulders back, throw your chest out, put on the breastplate of righteousness, stand in who you are in Christ, and I'll get you to the other side. Come on, church. It's our time. Who's going to get this done? Those who will serve the Lord. I'm delivered from what they want me to do. I'm delivered unto what God wants me to do. Come on, time to get our shout back, time to get our dance back, time to get our praise back, time to get our passion back, time to get our boldness back, time to get our vision back, time to get our hope in God back, hallelujah. It's not a time to be quiet, it's a time to serve the Lord. It's time to rise up, It's a time to forget. Yeah, I messed up, but Jesus forgave me. Yeah, I was a mess, but God's blood cleansed me. Yeah, I was an outcast, but I got brought in. Yeah, I was a nobody, but now I'm a somebody in Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm not going to live in the condemnation of my past. I'm going to live in the brightness of my future. Hallelujah. I'm going to be a part of this answer. Because while everybody else is fussing, I'm going to be proclaiming. Amen. Going to be proclaiming. I expect to see revival in my life. Woo, glory to God. Woo, come on, somebody give the Lord a praise. Come on, give him a praise. It's time for revival. It's time to see God move. What do we sing this morning? God's not dead, he's alive. Woo. See, Jesus told us this stuff so we'd be ready for it. So it wouldn't catch us off guard. So we'd be ready to stand. Sometimes it takes a little endurance. You just have to stand there for a while. You just have to just dig in, grit your teeth, and say, no, blessed be God, I'm not going to quit. Sometimes you got to come to church gritting your teeth. I ain't quitting. I ain't going back. No, you ain't getting me back in that devil. I know what Jesus brought me out of. I ain't going back in that. Are you hearing me? Live in the light of who you are in Christ, and you'll endure whatever the devil throws at you. Amen? Be seated. Come on. Praise God. Now get ready. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, what does he say? He says over here in verses 22, let's read about the communion. Watch this time. Watch this time. See, I preach to you now, you get to make a decision. See, you get to make a decision because every action starts off with a decision. Did you hear me? I have decided to follow Jesus. See, you don't follow till you decide. Joshua said, you need to make a choice. You need to decide. You're going to go backwards or you're going to go forward? He said, for me and my house, we have made a decision. Our decision is we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. So my actions are going to follow my decision. And so Paul tells us here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, he begins to tell us everything that Jesus did for us. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the same night which he was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke and said, take ye, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim. You declare, you show the Lord's death till he comes. What's he saying? He's saying the reason you're receiving at this table is you made a decision. I'm going to declare Jesus in my life. I'm going to proclaim Jesus in my life. I'm going to show the world that I'm serving Jesus in my life. That's why I'm coming to this table, because I'm renewing myself in him, that I'm going to show that Jesus died for my sins, was raised from the dead for my justification. He's coming back someday. Hallelujah. And I'm going to live my life in such a way that looks like he's coming back. So I'm going to proclaim Jesus in my actions. You can say it like this. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you make the declaration, I will serve the Lord till he comes. I will serve the Lord till he comes. So what does Paul say to us? He says in verse 27, here's what you do. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. What's he saying? He's saying the reason a lot of us are weak is because we haven't made that consecration to serve the Lord the way we're supposed to. And to get in on the blessing, you got to serve the Lord. In the Amplified, in verse 30, it says that careless and unworthy participation is the reason many of you are weak and sickly. That careless and unworthy participation. In other words, I haven't made the decision yet that no matter what comes, I'm going to stay with the Lord. I'm not going to bring anything to him. If I mess up, I'll be the first one to confess and repent of it. I'm all for grace, but I'm going to tell you what, folks. I'm not all for just living any way you want to live, calling it grace. Thank God for the grace of God. It gives me the drawing power of the Lord's love and compassion to pull me back to Him so I can repent and get saved and set free and forgiven of my sins when I mess up. I don't need you to be hard on me, because I'm going to be hard on myself. I'm going to be a lot harder on me than you could be on me. Because, see, I'm going to examine myself. I'm going to check myself out. I'm going to say, Lord, you did all this for me. How much am I giving you? And in the mess that's going on, listen to me, church. Listen to me. All of us, I'm sure, I'm going to confess my fault to you. All of us for sure have probably fussed, complained, murmured a little bit about all the stuff that's going on around us. That's exactly what the enemy wants us to do. Because you get caught up into it when you do. I examined myself, and the Lord said, quit fussing about this one and that one and this and that, and quit being upset over this. He said, that's exactly what the enemy's trying to do. He said, I warned you about this. He said, you're troubled over these things. You're causing you have problems. He says, put your eyes back on me. Don't let that stuff in you. Pray for it. Pray for those people. And lift your hands up and say, I'm going to serve the Lord. What's serving the Lord? Do the right thing. I'm going to do the right thing. And so Paul says, now when you come to this table, what you're going to say to the Lord is, Lord Jesus, I recognize that you have given your all to bring me into a covenant of blessing. Now I'm going to give you my all and show you to the world. And as I walk in this blessing, I'm going to be quick to give you the glory and let everybody know where it came from. Is that too hard? So that's what Josh said. If you think it's that hard, that evil, that troublesome, to just give God the glory for all the good things He's doing in your life and tell others about it. He said, but for me, I'm not going to be upset, fearful, ashamed. I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to serve the Lord and do the right thing. And when we do all these blessings, guess what? All of a sudden, healings begin to rise up in you. Strength rises up in you because God blesses you. And folks, I want to tell you, you have to make that decision every day. Every day it's a decision to serve the Lord. Listen, whenever I first got saved, I really committed to the Lord. I've told the story. I was playing football at East Tennessee State University. I was a junior in college, my junior year. Football season on, coaches said, we're going to have team day at the local church, the Baptist church. So all the team got together and all the coaches, and we sat and took up a big section of the church, and we were all there. And the preacher preached, and I couldn't really tell you what he preached to this day, but I can tell you this. At the end of this message, he said, and Jesus said, he's given an invitation for salvation. And Jesus said that if you be ashamed of me and of my words in this sinful and adulterous generation, then I'll be ashamed of you before my heavenly Father and the angels. You need to come to Jesus. And I said, Lord said, step out and come to me. I said, I don't want to do that in front of these guys. And the preacher preached that same scripture again. I said, I know I need to go up there, Lord. And by that time, the devil said, if you go up there, you're going to lose all your friends. If you go up there, the coach is going to think you're a Christian sissy. If you go up there, you'll never play for this team. By that time, the preacher said, if you're ashamed of me. I said, Lord, I want. And the Lord said, go up. And I said, Lord, I don't want to go up there. I'll do it privately later. And Jesus said, then you're ashamed of me. I said, no, sir, I'm not ashamed of you. I just don't want to go up there in front of these people. He said, why not? And the devil said, you'll lose all your friends. You'll lose all your buddies. I said, well, after the service, Lord, I'll pray when I get back to the room. He said, then you're ashamed of me. I said, well, Lord, I don't want to be ashamed of you. He said, then step out. And you know, I was faced with a decision that day. And it may seem silly now, but back then it was a major, life-changing, hard decision. Because I'm sitting there with thoughts, I'm going to lose friends. I'm never going to play on this team. I've got 2 more years. I just transferred in here. And the coaches aren't going to like me. It's going to cost me everything I've worked in my life. I've got a full scholarship. Everything I ever wanted, I finally got. I'm going to lose it all if I go give my life to Jesus. That's the thoughts that came to my mind. And the preacher stand up here telling me I'm going to be ashamed of Jesus if I don't show up. I'm thinking, he's not helping anything. I mean, you know, preaching that condemning message to me standing back here. But you know what? Right in the midst of all that, with the devil lying to me and all this stuff, I finally made the decision. You know what? I don't care if nobody likes me. I don't care if I never play. If they can take my scholarship, fine. I will never, ever, ever be ashamed of Jesus. And I took a step out of that row and I stepped out. And I made the decision. As for me, my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And I stepped forward. And Jesus, yeah, I'm going to tell you, that first step was hard. But the second step, Jesus was right there with me. And I walked right up to that front with Jesus. And I'm standing there, and what the devil forgot to tell me was this. 7 of my friends, my buddies on that team, got up and came forward and stood with me. And they gave their heart to Jesus too. And then after the service was over, from the head coach all the way down to the assistant, shook my hand and said, proud to have you on our team. It took a man to step out and do what you did today. We're glad. And everything the devil told me was a lie. And all that God had was for me just as soon as I made the decision to serve Him. I'm going to tell you what, that was my first decision. But you know, I've had to make decisions after that. Just like Joshua told the people, you've come into your inheritance, but there's still going to be a pull to pull you back. And I've had things that I've had to make a decision. Do I do the wrong thing or do the right thing? You know what, I'd like to tell you today that I've made every right decision, but I haven't. But even in the wrong decisions, I made a right one. Because when I saw it was wrong, I was quick to make a decision, ask God to forgive me and straighten it out. And He did. Because you see, I don't care what's going on in my life. I've made a decision. I will serve the Lord. May not be perfect at it, but with a perfect heart and a sincere heart, I will serve the Lord. And He's been faithful all the way. And I'm here to tell you today, He'll be faithful as the wars and rumors of wars continue. He'll be faithful when plagues come across the land. He'll be faithful when food's scarce. He'll be faithful when people hate me because I'm a Christian. He'll be faithful when I have friends that get upset and leave me and won't talk to me anymore. He'll still be faithful. And it'll still be worth it. And I'll still be blessed. Amen? Now that's what we're faced with in the hour we're living. Choose to serve the Lord. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank You now and praise You for Your goodness and mercy.